Hey everybody, my name is Jay Ball. I'm the product manager for solid milling from Seco Tools North America. Welcome back to Seco Tech Talk. And what I want to do with this episode is actually talk about plunge milling. I want to give you guys some tips and tricks on plunge milling with a, you know, whether it's an indexable or solid carbide product. And I want to talk about when and where to use it. And then also some tips and tricks on how to be the most efficient with plunge milling. So first thing I want to talk about is why would you ever want to plunge mill? Plunge milling is a very application-specific strategy, but it does have some really good uses. And once you find that sweet spot as far as application goes, it's really hard to beat. So just for an example, take a slot such as this feature right here. So you can see that maybe it's not super deep, but really where I find plunging to be most effective is when I have to machine something that's more than, say, 3 times D deep, right? Standard slot milling, standard dynamic machining really is either 1, 2, or 3 times D max. Once you start to push the 4 times D max, which is like on this high fee tool, plunge milling becomes a very, very effective strategy. So whether it's a slot like this component or maybe like this slot right here, but again, it's very application specific. It works extremely well though, like I said, once you kind of find that sweet spot. So just a little bit on kind of some of the applications and then, you know, why we would actually use slot milling. When it comes to tooling for plunge milling, we typically recommend high feed products. So we actually have a full line of Seco high feed, both indexable and solid milling products that are designed for plunge milling. And the really nice thing is in the catalog or on mypages.com, and we actually give you all the recommendations for all the speeds, feeds, depth of cut. But again, like I mentioned, we've got a whole ensemble of different high feed tools, such as this 218-19. We've got this high feed 2 here that's also designed for plunge milling. We've got this square 6, which is a 6-sided plunge milling insert cutter. But then we also have solid carbide tools from both Yabro and Niagara, such as this 2-flute tool right here, which is an SN200 or the Yabro 980, which are designed for plunge milling. So that's a little bit about, you know, why you would plunge mill. And then as far as the tools go, and then also some tips and tricks. So when it comes to plunge milling, you want to make sure that you do not plunge mill with a solid carbide tool more than 2 times the diameter depth of cut. So what do I mean by that? Let's say that you had a plunge mill, this slot feature, and this 1/2-inch tool here has 2 inches of reach and you had to go 2 inches down. What you'd want to do is only go 1 inch depth per plunge. So what do I mean by that? Yes, this tool has 2 inches of reach on a 1/2-inch tool. So what you want to do is you want to plunge mill down 1 inch, retract, and then plunge mill down 2 inches. So yeah, I get it. You're cutting air in that first 1 inch the second time, but what you've got to make sure that you do is relieve the cutting pressure on this edge. If you try to plunge mill 2 inches deep in one hit, you're going to start to get deflection. So just kind of keep that in the back of your mind. We're using solid carbide high feed tools that are designed for plunge milling. Make sure you do not plunge more than 2 times the diameter per plunge. Something else to keep in mind is your step over. That can kind of get us in trouble because the design of these high feed tools are actually designed to put all the load actually back up in the spindle. So what do I mean by that? You can get these long projections with these high feed tools. And what happens is the way this corner radius is designed, it actually puts all the cutting pressure back into the spindle. If you try to take too heavy of a step over though, it starts to push the tool off and you're gonna deflect. And let's face it, carbide doesn't like to deflect. It's gonna break, it's gonna chip. So again, when it comes to your radial stepover, you don't want to ever take more than 30% of the diameter radial stepover when it comes to plunge milling. And the nice thing is, like I said, guys, we've got all this cutting data in our catalogs and also on my pages, secotoolsmypages.com. So again, it's just some kind of tips and tricks when it comes to plunge milling. Last but not least, having a good holder is going to be key. So I've talked to this about this before in some of my short tech talk videos in the past, but you want to make sure the holders that you use are going to give you less than 4/10 run out. So some of the holders we like to recommend for plunge milling are gonna be your standard shrink fit holder or a hydraulic chuck, which works really, really well for plunge milling. And then some sort of high precision collet chuck. So we have this HP collet chuck system from Seco Tools, really good transmittable torque and repeatability. Again, all these holders are gonna give you less than 4/10 run out, especially when you get to these long overhangs, you can have a huge impact in your tool life if you get more than 4/10 run out. So again, just wanted to share with you guys some tips and tricks on how to be more effective with plunge milling or more efficient with plunge milling. Gotta be careful with this stuff. If you have any questions, make sure you guys leave your questions down in the comments, or if you guys wanna learn more about our high feed products, make sure you go to the Seco Tools My Pages website, check out all the great products and check out all the great literature. Really appreciate you guys' support. If you guys have any questions or comments, or there's anything more that you guys wanna know about plunge milling, make sure you leave those comments down in the comment box. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next Seco Tech Talk.